on the appointed gospel lesson of the day. When we consider the gospel lesson together, we connect our conversation, yours and mine, with the Spirit of God. And the sermon becomes more than that 10 or 12 minute event on a Sunday morning. At least let us hope it's not more than 10 or 12 minutes. And it continues with us into the week that we encounter. That's God's doing and the work of the Holy Spirit. What we share now in this sermon time by God's grace becomes the good news we take with us when we leave here. To share in all the everyday, you might almost miss it, ways that we grow to live and to speak the good news, and to share God's hope and peace with all others. Last week from the Gospel of Matthew, we considered the distinction between a disciple and an apostle. That a disciple is one who learns or trains for discipline, and an apostle is one being sent out to do what they have been discipled to do. And while none of us ever stops discipling, that is learning, there is that moment when we are called to live into the aim and purpose of our discipling, to be ones sent out to tell the promise of Jesus Christ, sent out to give out the hospitality, the hope, and the healing of God, like the 12 before us and all who follow Christ in every generation. We are disciples become apostles. Nourished and equipped by our prayer and scripture, our tradition and community, animated by the Holy Spirit in speaking out and doing the work of ministering to those in any kind of need. And this is the tradition of the apostles. This now is our legacy to embrace. And today, as we continue Matthew's gospel, we encounter most difficult words. Do not think that I have come to bring peace to the earth. I do not come to bring peace, but sword. For I have come to set a man against his father, a daughter against her mother, a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law, and one's own foes will be members of one's own household. Such words might tempt a sensible preacher to look the other way. To look for some other reading, the epistle, the psalm, something more palatable for a summer Sunday morning sermon. For indeed, these words are difficult to hear and in many ways seem to counter what many a Christian believes, that if we choose to live according to God's holy word, then our lives will be good and peaceful and quiet. Today's gospel seems to be saying anything but that. Like so much of Scripture, it beckons us to look beyond the surface, to look prayerfully, to see that God has a greater message in store, telling us there is more going on here than meets the world's eye. And to remember, first and foremost, that we are never beyond God's reach and loving embrace. Have no fear. Jesus tells us, remember, nothing will be covered, all will be known. We are God's own. And no matter what happens, no matter what it looks like to this world, our God delivers. Delivers us and embraces, even cradles us, life and soul, here and now, forever. There will be difficulty. There will be discord. But through it all, the God who watches over even the lowly sparrow watches over us and cherishes us. That's the promise. Have no fear. Don't be afraid or hesitate or look the other way. For as Jesus tells us, it is enough for the student to be like the teacher, for the disciple to become the apostle. Do as I do, and as I have taught you. In other words, and this is from the message, some of this is pretty pointed. If you don't go all the way with me through this and then, you don't deserve me. If your first concern is to look after yourself, you'll never find yourself. But if you forget about yourself and look to me, you will find both yourself and me. And with this promise, Jesus calls his apostles, the ones sent out. Jesus calls us, go forth, speak up, shout it out, stand and deliver. For the gospel tells us again from the message, don't be intimidated. Eventually, everything's going to be out in the open, and everyone will know how things really are. So don't hesitate. Go public now. Don't be bluffed into silence by the threats of bullies. There's nothing they can do to your soul, your core being. Save your fear for God, who holds your entire life, body and soul, in his hands. Don't hesitate to go public. Now, that is not what most of us want to hear, is it? Much less do. Being the hands and heart of Christ is one thing, but speaking up and out in this day and age is, I agree, as a Christian, quite another. Yet Jesus is calling, speaking to all God's people now as then, for Jesus dispatched his apostles to speak about everything he told them. What they heard in whispered intimacy of the nighttime conversation, which we now possess in our sacred scripture and holy tradition, what they heard in whispered intimacy, Christ now tells them to proclaim in the brightness of the day. Go public. Speak God's word. Seems we can do no less. This past week, I asked myself, how is Christ calling me? What is Christ calling me to do? Calling us to do? What can I do now to speak out in the light? To speak in non-political, non-judgmental, Christian faith-based ways? Where is Christ calling? And perhaps beginning to open to this question is the reason that I encountered on Tuesday on WITF, Smart Talk. The discussion was on the topic, Making America Civil Again. Carolyn Luskenmeyer was interviewed on the topic of civility, about reviving civility and respect, about teaching people how to listen to understand. She is the executive director of the National Institute for Civil Discourse, a fancy name for a simple mission, teaching us how to listen, to understand, and to respect. NICD, for short, is Tucson-based, established in May 2011 after the tragic Tucson shooting that killed 6 people and wounded 13 others, including former Congresswoman Gabrielle Giffords. These folks were participating in a Congress on Your Corner event, a fundamental act of our democracy. And in response to this tragedy, the Tucson community decided to come together and to create NICD, a partisan, nonpartisan organization based at the University of Arizona, that would, and I quote, promote healthy and civil debate. Luskenmeyer spoke of the current state of our culture, and I commend this interview to you. Speaking of civility, she suggested that most of us define it as, well, being nice to each other, avoiding conflict, and being politically correct. But originally, civility denoted the state of being a citizen. rose much later in the 16th or 17th century. She reported on the apathy and impossibility in the United States today, the inability to speak to someone who thinks differently. And she noted, it's even infected churches and synagogues. And that sounded like a spiritual quandary to me about us, the condition of our hearts, a condition that we best examine and truthfully assess. Last week, I asked you to consider with me taking on the mantle of disciples to become apostles, to follow the apostolic practices, praying daily, faithfully asking Christ's presence and guidance, pondering the stories of Christ's example and teachings in what we today have in scripture and sacred writings, and discerning in community what to do and then to go out and do it, going forth the hands and heart and voice of Christ in this world. And being Christ's voice in the world starts paradoxically by listening to understand, listening to heal, listening to reconcile, listening to become one. Being Christ's hand and heart and voice in this world has no room for finger pointing, perfuming, or fighting, but rather seeks to speak a word of compassion, understanding, and wholeness. In every generation, Christians have prevailed, proclaiming the word of God around the world and bringing hope to the hopeless and peace to those with no peace. Seems to me, we can do no less. So it's time again to ask, what is Christ calling me, calling us to do? How is Christ bidding you? How is Christ bidding me, bidding us to speak? Because there still are no exceptions, qualifications, or exclusions in Christ's call today.